of all, I would like to thank everybody who came here. Of course, Bob Cohen, the host, who hosts us here so nicely. Jack Muscat, thank you so much, the president of CAEF. Irving Weisdorf, who spoke beforehand. Andrea Spindle, of Bar Ilan Fellowship. Kerry Katz, MP Peter Kent, of course. Goldie Steiner, the head of Canadians for Israel Legal Rights, very important organization which actually makes high waves inside Israel, because recently a very important organization, Intirtzu, published a book which CILR was behind it, was written by Solomon Ben Zimra of blessed memory, the son of this town. And in Israel today, this booklet, as short as it is, actually makes high waves. Thank you so much, Goldie, for that. Shirley Ann Haber, of course, and dear friends Tova Asor, Ezra Rigley, many others. Ladies and gentlemen, debunking the Palestinian, the Palestinian people issue needs to address two sub-issues. First of all, the name Palestinian, and the second is people. Okay, we'll deal with both. Palestinian, this name, it's not in Arabic. It's in Arabic, there is no P. There's no letter P, so evidently it's not an Arabic, from the Arabic language. And the Palestinians, all of them are Arabs. So how could Arabs carry a name which cannot be pronounced by Arabs? So to begin with, from the linguistic point of view, there could not be a Palestinian Arab group, because in Arabic there's no word like Palestinian. That's why there is Palestine. Okay? But the original name is with P. Okay? So here is the first, I would say, weak point of the existence, mere existence of Palestinian. Now, everybody knows the history, that the country was named Palestine or Palestina by the Caesar Hadrian, 2nd century CE. He wanted to denigrate the Jews who rebelled against him, so he named the country in the name of their enemies, means the Philistines, those Greek group who actually came from the Aegean Sea near Greece as it is today, and they settled on the seashore for some hundreds of years. They made many problems to the Jews. At some point they disappeared, means they went back to their original environment, and they left in five towns on the seashore when they lived. By the way, one of them was Gaza. Remnants of Greek culture, pottery, everything which was written in Greek, means they were absolutely with no connection to the Arab world. They were Greeks. Okay? So today, Arabska means those who name themselves Palestinians, and they relate to a Greek group which was and left. Okay? Now, this naming yourself in the Middle East by a name of an ancient nation is a well-known practice. The Iraqis, the Iraqi Arabs, claim that they are the descendants of the Babylonians. And actually, Saddam Hussein claimed all the time that he has a list of his ancestors which come all the way to Hammurabi, one of the greatest kings of the Babylonians. Hammurabi, he's an Arab who came from the Arab Peninsula, means his ancestors. So all of a sudden he became a Babylonian. The Assyrians, Hafez Assad, claim that he is a descendant of Tiglath-Pileser, one of the great kings of the Assyrians. Okay? Believe it or not, they were northern Semitic, while the Arabs are southern Semitic, and not get into this, but from different area, different language, different minds, different everything. The Lebanese today claim that they are the descendants of the Phoenicians. Of course, the Phoenicians lived before Arabs came to this area, they came under the flag of Islam in the 7th century to occupy all those countries, the Babylon, what formerly was Babylonian, Assyriac, Phoenician, whatever. So, and once they are there, they changed the whole culture to Arabic. However, today, they started to talk about their ancestors, the local people, as if they have any connection. Egyptians the same. Egyptians also came, most of them, came from the Arab Peninsula, invaded Egypt, exterminated the Christians, I'm talking about the 7th century, means this, exterminated the men and took the women. Now they claim that they are the descendants of the pharaohs who reigned Egypt 4,000 years ago. Okay, this is very well known practice in the Middle East to occupy not only the country, not only the land, to occupy the history, to appropriate, I would say, the history of the local area in order to make ourselves. Now, this is something which is connected to the Bedouin culture. You know, a Bedouin tribe lives somewhere in the desert, and they have a well, and one day the well is exhausted. They don't know no water anymore because they drank everything. So now they have to wander to another place. So they send somebody to look for a place, and he finds another place with trees. So trees means that there is water under it. So they all go at night, because it's not so hot. They go at night, they sell there, put their tents in the place, and they go to sleep. In the morning, people who live in this area come, and they say, what are you doing here? Well, where do you come from? So they say, well, we are here for 1,000 years. Here is my father buried, here is my mother buried, here is my grandmother, my grandfather. And they say it with, you know, seriously, with poker face. Okay, this is the practice in the Middle East, to come at night or to come at some point and to claim that we are here thousands of years. After all, we have to live. If they don't come to a place with water, they will die. So they have to employ any means to convince the others that they have the right to be here, especially since they are here for thousands of years, and my father, mother, grandpa, grandma are buried all here. They came last night, and they concoct all these stories. Okay, so this is, unfortunately, the culture of the Middle East. The same thing is to name ourselves in the names of people who lived here thousands of years ago to prove that we belong in this country. Okay, this is the whole idea, just like in the water, in the desert. So it's part of the culture of the Middle East to come, to appropriate everything. By the way, the same thing Islam did with Judaism and Christianity. Because according to Islam, Abraham was the first Muslim. Jesus Christ was also a Muslim. And King Solomon built a mosque in Jerusalem. This I would call re-engineering of history according to those who try to appropriate the place based on fake history. Fake news were not created in the 21st century. Fake news in the Middle East are too much. The name of the game. If you have enough good stories, you win the war on stories. Okay? This is. Okay? Now we have to dig into history, the real history, and to find what. So, to begin with, the Palestinians definitely named themselves after a Greek group which was and left, and it's much, you know, much easier to name themselves after the Palestinians, right, or Philistines, rather than Arabs who invaded the country in the 7th century, as the reality is. So this is, first of all, we, means those who know the reality, should keep an erring hey, Palestinians, they were not Arabs. Okay? I rarely hear it in the media, especially in media in this part of the world, the hemisphere. Okay? So, this first of all. Secondly, not only this, that the Palestinians are actually, it's a fake news, the existence. They even say it. They even admit. Let me show you a little clip of the Minister of Foreign Affairs of Hamas. His name is Fath Haman. As you know, Gaza is in siege, not only by Israel, but also by Egypt. And after all, Gaza has borders with Israel and with Egypt. Some miraculous way, the world doesn't know that Egypt is part of the siege no less than Israel. Who knows that Egypt also closed the borders with Gaza, okay? The world is not aware of it. Only Israel is the problem, okay? So, let me show you. Once, Fatih Hamad, the Minister of Foreign Affairs of the Palestinian of Hamas government, once, you know, complained about the siege which Egypt puts on Hamas or on Gaza. Look at this. Egyptians and the other half Saudis. Well, he was not that accurate because many Palestinians carry names like, of course, Al Masri, as I said, Masri means Egyptian, Fayumi is part of Egypt, but they also have names like Al Horani. Horani means from the Horan in Syria. Al Sorani with S means from Tyre, from Sor, the town of Tyre. On the Lebanese shore, Sidawi from Sidon, another town on the Mediterranean shore, Tarabulsi means the one from Tripoli in Lebanon, not in Libya, Karaki, a town in Jordan, and Zarqawi, big family in Jordan, from Zarqa in Jordan. So, they actually carry names which testify where they came from. Like what we have, Berliner and Frankfurter. The same thing. You mark a person or a family with the name of the city which they came from for various reasons. In their case is that nobody will let them mess with our daughters because they are nicht unserer, not from us. Okay? Because he is Masri, and he is Horani, and he is Sorani. And you know, tribalism as part of it is marriage within the tribe. So here they name other people with the names which will mark them forever in order not to let their children get too close to our daughters. This is the idea behind naming with the cities. Okay, so he admits it, it's not me. Actually, if you take the Israeli fungi, the book of the names of the people, you can see all the towns and villages in the Middle East sent, even not only there is a big family in the Israeli north who also consider themselves Palestinians, Bushnak. Bushnak means from Bosnia, from Yugoslavia. They came as soldiers in the Ottoman army in the 19th century. And they settled in Israel, and since nobody marries with them because they are nicht unserer, not from us, so they keep their family Bushnak as it is, because nobody, okay? This is how it works in the Middle East. It's not like here that everybody came as individual, and after a generation, two, three generations, everybody marries everybody else. It's not in the Middle East. Middle East tribalism is alive and kicking, if not also alive and killing. So, this is as it is in Iraq, in Syria, Yemen, Sudan, big time. Okay, Libya, tribes are killing each other for long time. So this is actually the issue. Palestinians, or the Palestinian, is a matter of adopting a name of an ancient group which lived there, just like what the Iraqis did with the Babylonians, the Assyrians, and others. The Palestinians did the same thing, and of course, now the word people. People are also individuals, because it's an ambiguity in English. It's individuals, and people is like a nation, synonym of a nation. Okay? That's why we say peoples, in plural means nations. Okay? Now, they name themselves a people, means a nation, which is another, I would say, adopting of a concept from the West. Why? In the modern Middle East, there are no nations. There is only one nation, the Arab nation, which extends all the way from Morocco in the West on the Atlantic, all the way to Iraq in the East, from Syria in the North to Yemen in the South. This is the only nation which there is, because they are all Arabs, they define themselves as Arabs, speak Arabic, and so forth. What we see today, the modern states, Iraq, Syria, Egypt, Tunisia, Libya, Algeria, all these states are artificial states, because they were marked by the colonialists, the British, the French, and the Italians. Libya was under Italian. So, and the proof is that the borders are marked with a ruler. And a ruler is called is something which is marked arbitrarily by somebody who sat in some cellar in London or in Paris and marked borders according to their own interests. See these rulers. Look at this. This is 800 kilometers. This is 1,000. This is 1,200 kilometers, like 800 miles. Of a ruler. Strange. Maybe you cut some group in the middle if they live there, or maybe you merge together groups which historically didn't live in peace with each other. Who cares? In the days of the colonialism, the indigenous peoples were not on the map for the colonialists, neither in the Middle East nor in other parts of the globe. Here as well. Okay, so they care only about themselves. This was the day, those were the days. Okay, so they marked artificial states according to the parcellation of the countries which they did in order to serve their own interests, whether it is oil, as it is in Iraq, or passage in the Suez Canal, as it is in Egypt. I won't elaborate on this, but the modern Arab state is an artificial entity which in most cases failed in replacing the traditional loyalties in plural. What do I mean? Because of the fact that the Middle East is a desert, you have to live in a tribe. You cannot live as an individual because the individual cannot defend the source of water. You have to live in a group. And the tribe means the family, the father and the sons, is the most consolidated group. After a generation, it's cousins. And after another generation, second cousin, third cousins. What do we get? Clan, extended family, tribe. The name doesn't make any difference. The essence is what there is. The tribe, you can call it the clan, is the cornerstone of the societies in the Middle East. If you don't understand the mindset of a group which live together, marry the daughters inside the group with a heavy price of genetic problems which they preserve by marrying the cousin, second cousin, third cousin for generations. Look, in Israel, the Arab villages are also tribes. If you tell me the name of somebody, I'll tell you where he lives. Because according to the name, I know where he lives. Because the tribes live in different, and they don't move from place to place. Because in your hometown, you are Ibn al-Balad, means one of us. If you move to another village, which is 2 kilometers far, you are a stranger. According to the Arab definition, homeland is the village or the extended family. This is the homeland. If you migrate to another village which is across the road, you are a stranger who live in a place which does not belong to you. And you will be of lower class socially. Maybe you, if you get married there, you will get a lady who is has a short leg, or doesn't see, or doesn't hear, or something, which nobody wants her. This is whom they will let you marry in order to solve the problem. This is the reality. And this is the social reality in the Middle East. Iraq, for example, this is the map of the tribes in Iraq. This is the map. Okay? And every tribe has its own dialect. Once you open your mouth, everybody knows which tribe you are, whether you are a Galicianer or a Bukoviner. Okay? We know it also. Every tribe has its leadership. Every tribe has a fighting militia. And you don't mess with them. Because first of all, they will kill you. Then they will ask who you were and what you wanted. Because in the Middle East, you cannot allow yourself to be non-violent. In the Middle East, if you shoot the second, you don't shoot anymore. Ever. Why? Because you are dead already. This is why violence in the Middle East is such an immediate tool to use in every feud, in every struggle. Why? Because you cannot allow yourself to be non-violent when the other side is violent. Because if you are nice and cute and non-violent, he will kill you. So it's a luxury to be non-violent in such an area where you have to struggle for your water and for other things. So, this is why tribalism, on the way of how you live as a tribe, is so typical to the Middle East. By the way, to live in a tribe has also advantages. If, let's say, if somebody breaks his leg, and he has to lie in bed for 2 months with the leg tied up, everybody will come. One will come to run his business, so he doesn't go bankrupt. Another one will come every morning to take his children to school, because he cannot drive. Another one will come to take his children back from school home so they come safely. Another one will go to the refrigerator to make sure that there is food in the refrigerator, and he will look at very carefully inside and count whatever there is. If it's not enough, he will go to the marketplace and to buy whatever needed, and he will send his wife to cook. Men do not cook in these societies. So, and this is why? Because I broke my leg. Everybody will come. And you don't have to say anything to anybody. Everybody comes, looks around, what is not being done, and it gets under the stretcher. This is how tribal communities act. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm not sure that living as a single in New York City and maybe die in your apartment and nobody knows until everybody smells what happens in your apartment, I'm not sure that this lifestyle is better than living in a tribe where everybody knows all the time what happens with everybody. Like, I would say, bees in the house, you know? That they always correspond with each other, exchange the data, exchange information. This is how what they do. And this is why they can function as a group. So this is the Middle East, for God and for bad. This is how it is to live in a tribe. Okay? Now, as a result, there is no Iraqi nation. Iraqi nation is an artificial word to describe the fact that all the Iraqi citizens have the same passport or the same identity card, the same, I don't know what other cards, but they don't marry each other. So there is no nation. The British, when they marked the borders around Iraq, they hoped that with the years, thanks to the fact that they have one government, one leader, ruler, one flag, one national anthem, one ministry of whatever, one army, one police, they all will abandon the tribal thinking, will all adopt the Iraqi modern mindset, and they will sit all around one fire and sing Kumbaya together in perfect harmony. John Baez, you remember? Okay, I want to teach the whole world. Okay, this is what the British hoped almost 100 years ago when they created Iraq. Where is the problem? It didn't happen. Tribes remain tribes, and other groups like Kurds and Arabs remain Kurds and Arabs and others. Sunnah remained Sunnah, and Shia remained Shia, and Muslims remained Muslims, and Christians and Yazidis and all the others group remained loyal to their identities, and they did not dissolve into each other and make one milkshake and one Iraqi nation. So there is no Iraqi, there are Iraqi citizens, but not Iraqi nation. Unlike in this country, once you get the Canadian papers, you become a Canadian. And your neighbors in the south, once you get the American papers, you become an American. Okay? Because what defines you as Canadian, as much as I understand, is the papers. Once you are a citizen, you are a Canadian. Whether you speak English or French or not. Okay? This is what happens here. Here, because it is a country of immigrants, this is why you define nationalism in a different way. There, nationalism is defined by marriage, and since they don't get married with each other, there is no Iraqi nation. Okay? The same thing with Yemen, for example. Let me show you. And fasten your seatbelt. This is the map of Yemen, of the tribes of Yemen. This explains the atrocities in Yemen. Why Yemenites and Iraqis as well, why they fight each other? Because they do not have the awareness of one nation, because they are tribes, and the tribes preserved the tribal mindset, the tribal awareness way much more than they adopted the new idea of Iraqi nation, which actually came from the West, which is a Western idea. Nationalism was developed in Europe for the Europeans. Okay, the same thing is with Libya, and I can show you all the maps of the tribes in the modern Arab world. And this is actually the genetic main problem of the modern Arab states. And if you understand this problem, you can understand why these countries are failing states. Because the state tries always to impose the state mindset on all these groups, and all the groups view the state as the enemy, because the state wants to extract our culture and to push everyone of us into the other, and who wants it? Okay, the state tries to impose itself. And this is why the state is viewed as the enemy. in most of this, only the tribe which took over the whole place, like the Dulaimis, the tribe of Saddam Hussein, the Qaddafis, the tribe of Qaddafi in Libya, only they think that the state is legitimate because they control everything. But all the other groups view them as rulers, vicious as they are, okay? And this is all over the Middle East. You cannot miss it in Jordan. You can see it very well in Syria. And I actually dedicated my PhD to the attempts of the Assad regime, means the father Assad regime, to create a awareness of togetherness. And the more he tried, the more he failed. Why? Because as long as people do not get married with other groups, there is no nation. You can talk about this day and night. It will not change the situation on the ground. Okay? So this is, in a nutshell, in a pistachio shell, the cause of the modern history of the Middle East. This explains the wars between the Kurds and Arabs in Iraq. This explains the wars inside Syria until today, for dozens of years. This explains why Sudan, a country with 600 tribes, was an atrocity since it was established in the 40s. This is why Yemen today is an atrocity. You know, Yemen is such an atrocity today. It's not only war between the government and the Houthis. The government is supported by Saudi Arabia and the Houthis are supported by Iran. What they have today in Yemen is two things which the world succeeded to get rid of: typhoid and cholera. Two diseases which are caused by one thing: the lack of sewage. And the whole sewage system in Yemen is destroyed because of the war. For sewage you need electricity. For sewage you need maintenance of pumps and everything which comes with sewage. So, and when the country doesn't function, what you get is typhoid and cholera. To that degree, the Arab world goes backwards in history, even in the health system. So this is the result of the fact that the states do not reflect the culture or the social culture of the Middle East. Now, as a result of the fact there are no nations, I can even say frankly that there is no Israeli nation as well. Why? Israel has two major groups in Israel of citizens: Jews and Arabs. Arabs are 20% of the citizens of the state of Israel. 71 years of independence, Jews remained Jews, Arabs remained Arabs. Cases of marriage between Jews and Arabs are very, very rare. And Jews remained loyal to their Jewish identity, while Arabs remained loyal to their Arab identity. The state doesn't want, the state doesn't even tries to merge them together, to force on them a modern Israeli mindset which will be detached from Judaism on one side and Arabism on the other side. Because Israel is a democracy, everyone lives the way he likes. So Jews are Jews, Arabs are Arabs, and there is no one unit Israeli nation detached from Judaism here and Arabism there. Okay, so the state of Israel as well did not create an Israeli nation, artificial modern nation detached from the heritage of it. Okay, the same thing is with the Palestinians as well. I mean, if there is no Iraqi nation, no Syrian nation, no Israeli nation, is there a Palestinian nation? Or Palestinian people as a single group of people? Okay, the same thing. A girl from Hebron has no option to get married to a boy from Nablus. Why? Again, they're not from us. They speak different Arabic. Not to mention the Arabic in Gaza, which is a derivative of the Bedouin Arabic, which came from Saudi Arabia. While those who live in Judea and Samaria, their language is a derivative of the Syrian dialect. which is distinct from the Saudi Arabian dialect. Okay, I'll give you a little example. In Saudi Arabia, a cow is bagara. In Syria, it's bakara, with kuf. Okay, they pronounce the Arabic in a different way. And this actually defines these two branches of Arabic. And it's not only the language, it's also the culture, it's also the customs, and many other things which define group of people. So to say that the Gaza is part of the Palestinian nation, first of all, there's no such a nation, because there are tribes, and Gaza definitely is distinct from the other parts of in Judea and Samaria. So this is what we have to understand. First of all, the Palestinian name is something which they adopted, like the Iraqis who adopted the Babylonians, and the word people as synonym to nation is also doesn't exist, because it doesn't exist anywhere in the Middle East, neither in Iraq nor in Syria nor even in Israel. By the way, the only successful countries in the Middle East are the Gulf Emirates. Why? Some would say because of the oil, right? Wrong. Dubai has no oil and no gas. And Dubai is one of the richest countries in the world. Dubai, no gas, no oil. Maybe 1% of their GDP is based on oil and gas. Iraq has a lot of oil. And Iraq is a failing state. Libya, hell of a failing state. Yemen, Sudan are also producing oil, and they are failures. So evidently, the oil is not what makes good life in the Middle East, because if oil was the issue, Iraq and Libya and Yemen and Sudan would be heaven, and Dubai would be a hell. But the situation is totally opposite. Dubai is a heaven without oil, while Iraq, Libya and so forth are hell with oil. So that evidently the oil is not the element which brings good life to the Gulf. So what brings good life to the Gulf? The fact that each and every one of the Arab Emirates, and I'm talking about Kuwait, Qatar, and the seven Emirates of the United Arab Emirates. Okay? Now, just a little comment about the United Arab Emirates. They are united not like Ontario, Saskatchewan, and the British Columbia. They are united like Germany, France, Spain, and Belgium. You get the difference? Ontario is not sovereign. Okay? Saskatchewan is not sovereign. Sovereignty belongs to the Union. Am I right? Okay? There, in Europe, Germany is sovereign, France is sovereign, Holland, Belgium, Spain, okay? They united some things like the currency, but they did not unite the government, and therefore the European Union is a union of states, in full sovereign states. While here, it's a combination of something which is below the state, because Ontario is no sovereignty. Okay, now the United Arab Emirates are more like Europe than like Canada. Okay, so they are, because I'm talking about Dubai and Abu Dhabi, Ras Al Khaimah, Fujairah. Okay, these Emirates which are independent, separate, and sovereign. They united the currency, they united the foreign policy, they won one embassy here in Canada, and Canada has one embassy there, united the foreign policy, and they united the army. They did not unite the police, they did not unite the investigation. How do you call the Canadian FBI?
RCMP.
They do not have this RCMP. They do, because they hide secrets from each other. Okay? And they did not unite the economies. They're a different economy. Everyone has its own economy. Okay? So they are more like the European Union rather than Canada or the United States of America. Okay? So altogether we have seven states here, in addition to Qatar and Kuwait. These are the richest countries. countries in the world. Why? If not the oil, so what the reason? The reason is each and every one of them has one single tribe. Homogeneous society, unlike heterogeneous societies in the other modern Arab states. Okay? And this makes a difference. Because once a tribe rules itself, it's Al-Sabah in Kuwait. Al in Arabic is family, extended family. Al, by the way, it comes from the word in Arabic, Ahal. Ahal is actually in Hebrew, Ohel, which is tent. So they say the tent of Sabah, we say Beit Israel, the house of Israel. What's the difference? The same thing. They live in a tent, we live in a house, so we call it the habitat, actually, we use the same, okay, it's the same idea. So Kuwait is Al-Sabah, that's the name of the family. Qatar is Al-Thani, Abu Dhabi is Al-Nihyan. Okay, every one of them is one Al. And when one tribe go, look, I'm not talking about the Canadian and American and European business people who live there in order to make money. They are not part of the accounts in the citizenship. I don't count also the foreign workers which come from Bangladesh to work in construction, and if they survive after a year, they go back home with some money. Okay, I'm talking about the citizens, who are, by the way, minority, but because they use others, their effort is spent on walking to the bank to deposit the checks. That's all they do. So, yeah, and signing, you know, it's not easy. So this is the good life in the Gulf, not because they have oil. They are rich even without oil, because the society is homogeneous, stable, functioning. On the society you build a political arena which is strong and functioning, and all this you build skyscrapers with helicopter pads on them, so when the tenants want to go to the private jet to go to the French Riviera, they don't have to stand in red line because they take the helicopter which belongs to the building. Okay, rich people, not because of the oil, because they work together rather than fighting together, because they are one single tribe. The leadership of the Emirate is the same families who led those tribes 200 years ago when they were riding camels in the desert. Okay? Today they are riding golden Lamborghinis. What's the difference? The velocity? The camel is 4-on-4, the Lamborghini is 4-on-4, and both have leather seats. The speed is different. So what? And they combine modern tools with tradition. I'll give you an example. In those years, 200 years ago, until 50 years ago, a bride was taken from her father's home to the wedding party on a camel, and the camel was covered with ornamentations dedicated to weddings. Okay, traditional ornamentation. But today they don't have camels anymore, because camels stink. So they have Lamborghinis. Mercedes is the poor people, that's what they go. So what do they do? They kept all the ornamentations and they stick them on the Lamborghini of the father of the bride. And this is how she goes to the wedding, with a golden modern Lamborghini with traditional ornamentations. Very nice combination of tradition and modernism. Very good, why not? And this is how, because they adhere to the traditions which are embedded in the state law, the state is legitimate, the leaders, you know, in the Gulf, they don't have elections. Why don't they have elections? They don't need elections. In our countries, what are elections? We elect a group of people to run the country. After they fail, we exchange them in another group. And after they fail, we exchange them in another group. So what is democracy? A system where, okay, where the failure is embedded in the system. Forgive me, okay? But then, okay, in those countries, a failure is not an option because a leader has responsibility to the people, way before anything else, for himself, for his family. He is responsible for everyone. The tradition in tribal society is that when there is a shortage of water, the leader will be the last to drink. He will sit aside and make sure that everybody drank, including the kids. Only then he will go to the water and drink something. If there is a shortage of food, he will be the last to eat, because he has responsibility. So this is totally different. And he will be in charge of the people as long as he has a mind, or as long as he's alive, because he's the oldest guy, he has the ethos of the tribe on his heart, he is the judge between everybody, and he talks to everybody, knows how to lead. And you know, they are elected in silence. This is the tradition. When, let's say, the former leader passed away, they bury him, and the heads of the families come to a room or a tent, they sit silently, and they all look at one. And he knows that he has no other choice but to be the leader. It is imposed on him by everybody who looks at him because of his characteristics. He's kind, he's old, he knows everything, he is a good leader, he is a natural leader. He is not a ruler and not a politician, he is a leader. And this is why, after everybody looks at him, he understands that he is trapped in this position of leadership, and he is a leader. This is how it goes. Legitimately, between you and me, what fits better such kind of society? Democracy, socialism, communism, all these isms which were brought from Europe, or something which comes from below, from the culture of the region, because of the characteristics of the societies? And this is what tribalism is. It has good aspects, it has problematic aspects, it has everything in it. We have to learn it. By the way, a Canadian guy, Paul Saltzman, he is an anthropologist in McGill, wrote a magnificent book, which I highly recommend, Culture and Conflict in the Middle East. He lived, of course, he lived in Pakistan, but it's the same kind of society. And he documented everything for years which he lived in Pakistan. And this book actually gives you the real characteristic, or the real nature of what it is to live within a tribe. Culture and Conflict in the Middle East, Paul Saltzman, McGill University. I am now writing a continuation, a second volume of his book, under another title, Alive and Killing, Tribalism in the Modern Arab World. And I take from what he finished, I go forward to other things like economy, like state building, like all kinds of things, or which can show very easily how the family plays a role in the Middle East before anything else. So, but don't hold your breath until you see the book. So, this is actually the essence. When you come back to the Palestinians, and we understand the nature of societies in the Middle East, we actually come to the solution, the only solution which can survive for the Palestinians. Should we take the failing paradigm or the successful paradigm? Of course the successful. Who with the right mind will build another failure like Syria, like Iraq, which might become another Hamastan, either by elections as was in 2006, when Hamas won the majority of the seats of the Legislative Council of the Palestinians, or by coup d'etat, as happened in Gaza in June 2007. Who with the right mind will establish a state which will turn into a Hamastan within no time, either by elections or by coup d'etat? has happened already. Okay? You know, Albert Einstein, he was a physicist. He once said that insanity is repeating an experiment and hoping for a different result. If you repeat the experiment, you'll get the same result. So if you hope to get another result, you're insane. So we tried it already in Gaza. The same thing will be in the West Bank, so-called, if there is a Palestinian state. Who in the right mind? By the way, this is why in Israel, after the elections, which were like a month ago, there is no left left. Because everybody in Israel, even the left, understands that the Palestinian state, which was the hardest card of the left in Israel, nobody really wants it. Because people today understand what will happen in any Palestinian state if it will be a state like Syria, like Iraq, conglomerate of times. Those who didn't realize, for 12 years, Gaza is a state, whether we like them or not. They have borders, they have government, they have a ministry of any kind which needed, they have military industry, they know how to produce projectiles and shoot them at Israel. They know how to, they have an army, they have police, they have borders, they have whatever a state needs. And not only this, Gaza is not only a state. Gaza is a super state. Why? They succeeded with the 12 years to force their enemies to supply them with food, with water, with oil, with electricity. And whenever a lady in Gaza has problems in childbirth, she is being brought to the border with Israel. An Israeli ambulance comes back to back to bring her to Israel to give birth to the next jihadist in a much better environment in the Israeli health system. Okay? This is why Gaza is a super state, which succeeded to force its enemies to feed them, to drench them, to supply them with oil and electricity, and to make sure that the next generation of jihadists is born safely in the Israeli hospitals. Okay? This is why Gaza is a state. Okay? We have issues with Gaza. They don't like us. Apparently we don't like them. And we have to live side by side with them on a basis of deterrence, as we lived with Egypt until we had peace agreement with Egypt in 1979, as we lived with Jordan, which was a very problematic country until the peace agreement was signed in 1994, and those who still view the Oslo agreements as some kind of a Palestinian recognition, PLO recognition in Israel, can also view the Oslo agreements as some kind of peace, temporary peace, which Arafat, by cheating us, gave us this document which is called peace. So this is what we have, and all these things were achieved by the fact that Israel is viewed as invincible. Arabs do not like us because we are a different tribe or different group. Our religion, according to Islam, is null and void. Jews are not a nation. Jews are, according to what they think, Jews are communities which belong to all the nations in the world, and therefore there is no justification to establish any state for the Jews, even in the size of a stamp on the seashore of Tel Aviv. Okay? So this is why, in their view, Israel has no reason to exist. The whole raison d'etre of Israel is null and void. So this is why we have to convince them that we have the right to our forefathers' land. We made it in 48. We succeeded with a giant price of a whole percent of the people, Jewish people, which succeeded to survive. 56 we won, 67 we won. The attrition war between 1969 and 70, we won. 73 with a tremendous price, we succeeded to push them back. And okay, so they understood that Israel is invincible. And in the Middle East, peace means temporary peace is being given to an entity which is viewed as invincible, and this peace will continue only as long as this entity is viewed as invincible. So Israel can enjoy temporary peace. But if Israel remains invincible forever, we can enjoy temporary peace forever. Welcome to the Middle East. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Professor Kedar, for your illuminating remarks. And we're going to have questions right now, because I think that it's so interesting. You know, we live in the West, and we really think through Western eyes. But when you get an understanding of how other cultures think, then you have to see things through their eyes. And I'd like to just read a quote to you that came out recently by Rashiba Talib that has upset the community. I'm sure you've heard of it, but in light of the way we discussed Palestinian and Bedouin and how historical revisionism comes so easily, I'd like your comment. This is what she said: there's always a kind of calming feeling I tell folks when I think of the Holocaust and the tragedy of the Holocaust and the fact that it was my ancestors, Palestinians, who lost their land and some lost their lives, their livelihood, their human dignity, their existence in many ways, had been wiped out in some people's passports. Now my question is she consciously lying or unconsciously lying?
Well, first of all, she has selective memory. What do I mean? 1944, the Nazis collected the Jews of Hungary to Budapest, and they wanted to take them to Auschwitz to go through the chimneys. But, you know, there were more than 500,000 people, 539,000 Jews, Hungarian Jews. But they were afraid that the partisans would blow up the bridges of the trains which were supposed to take those Jews to Auschwitz. So they asked the Palestinian Mufti, Haj Amin al-Husseini, to go to Yugoslavia, to Bosnia, and to Bulgaria to recruit people to be Waffen-SS to guard the bridges. And this is how they succeeded to take so many Jews from Hungary to be exterminated. Without the help of the Palestinians to this death machine of the Germans, there is a big question mark if those Jews from Hungary would be exterminated. Ladies and gentlemen, Rashida Talib forgot this part of the one who founded the Palestinian modern national movement, Haj Amin al-Husseini, his role in the Holocaust. I would remind her when I meet her, if she dares to meet with me.
Thank you, thank you. Question over here. Thank you.
Does the emergence of MBS in Saudi Arabia have any impact on the dynamics you described today, in your opinion?
Well, in very short, the Saudis today, their fear from the Iranians is much bigger than their hate to Israel. MBS, means Muhammad bin Salman, personally, I highly doubt if he will ever be a king. Although he is the crown prince, I'm at all not sure that he will one day succeed his father. First of all, the choosing of him by his father was illegitimate in the eyes of the most part of the ruling family in Saudi Arabia, because actually he went around dozens of his cousins who were already ministers, commanders of in the army, ambassadors, managers of big companies. They did something in life, while he, what did he do? Almost nothing. Nothing. This is one thing. Secondly, he's young. And in the Bedouin culture, you cannot go around the old guy. If he is cogent, if he is normal, if he is a tzechel, you cannot circumvent him. You cannot nominate somebody who's young, because young, the word in Arabic is young and stupid, the same word. And old and clever, old and wise, sheikh, is the same word. Because somebody who's old accumulated experience. So this is why he's much more clever than a young guy. So the current king actually started the next generation, you know, until this very day. Salman is the brother, half-brother, of the former king, Abdallah, who was the former brother, or brother of Fahd, and Sultan, and Khalid, and Saud. Okay, all the six sons of the founding father of the kingdom, Abdulaziz ibn Saud. Now, maybe came the time to move the kingship to the generation of the grandsons. Okay, so the current king took his beloved young son, and again, circumventing all the others. The sons of the former kings were much more experienced, did something for Saudi Arabia. This is why his nomination is illegit. Secondly, a year and a half ago, he captured many of his cousins in Thousand Star prison, the Ritz-Carlton of Riyadh, and he forced them not to live in the rooms of the hotel, in the lobby. Imagine, billionaires, his cousins, are lying on the carpet at night without anything to change. Some of them were luxurious. They lied on chairs which they lined up. This is how you treat your cousins? Okay? And two of them who ran away, he actually murdered them. Okay? So he opened the account of blood revenge, which is another part of the Arab, of the Bedouin culture. Okay? So his nomination was illegitimate. His behavior is illegitimate. And what he did to Khashoggi in October of 2018 actually more tarnished his image, because who sows people? Okay? By the way, one of his epithets today is in Arabic, Abu Minshar. Abu Minshar in Arabic is a sore. So he is the man with the sore. Okay? So he is, in my view, illegitimate, and he now he tries to gain legitimacy with Americans, with other people in the world. Domestically, I think that he is erased, and I'm at all not sure that he will be the next king.
Okay, thank you. Question here?
Yeah. You commented on the quote from, was her name, Rashida Tlaib?
Yes.
What's interesting isn't that she made it, we know what she is. What's interesting is that the Washington Post rushed to defend her, printed a whole series of articles saying how wonderful and right she was and all the rest of it. And the question for you is, why would the Washington Post defend such blatant anti-Semitism? And B, what, if anything, can be done to make them start stopping fake news, to stop the blatant bigotry?
Well, what makes the Washington Post publish such a thing? For this, I have to dedicate time to study the American media or the American mindset. Unfortunately, I spent the last 53 years in trying to understand the Middle East, which is as far as could be from American mindset. Maybe in my next life, I will change direction and I study United States. However, I think that today, what happens in this continent, not only the United States of America, is actually what we saw in Europe like 15 years ago. When political correctness paralyzes any criticism against all kinds of people like her, where multiculturalism actually destroys every characteristic of the society by adopting all kinds of ideas which cannot work, and the post-colonial discourse which also makes people, you know, to repent for the atrocities which we Westerners did in all kinds of countries like the Middle East, Africa, South America, maybe here as well. So when the culture changes from what it was to what it is today in Europe, you can see there. In my view, North America is behind Europe with like time lapse of 15 years difference. Because what you see here today, you saw in Europe 15 years ago. So if you want to maybe see what might happen here in 15 years, look at Europe today. This is what when people lose their antibodies to another culture which invades other lands in order to take them over. Not in order to become Americans or Canadians or whatever, or Europeans, but in order to take those countries over. And unfortunately, people are either doped or motivated by the will to stick themselves to the chairs in the parliament forever. Why? Because when the street becomes different, you have to sing the songs which the streets wants you to sing. Means to legislate, to promote all kinds of things which the street, which changes, wants you to promote. And this is when the politicians actually are pushing this process rather than stopping it.
Thank you. Question in the back here.
Thank you very much, Professor.
Sir,
for a great talk.
Could you speak up, please, so everyone can hear
I'm
you.
Interested to know, at the end of your presentation, where you talked about a proposed solution of the Emirates, have you shared this with Kushner? And specifically, how is this idea received by Israel and other parties in the Middle East? Because I'm hearing it for the first time.
Thank you for the question. Yes, I met the highest echelon in the American National Security Council, December 2017. I sat with them, I gave them all the data, and the website, which they can take all the data from there, which is www.palestinianemirates.com. Very easy to memorize, palestinianemirates.com, one word. In Israel, so far, four ministers invited me by their own initiative to explain the idea or to explain the logic behind this thing. And I know that Netanyahu knows about this because his sister-in-law, who is a good friend of mine, Daphne Netanyahu, the wife of his brother, of bigger brother, told me personally that it came in one of the Friday's dinners, the family dinners, and he says, yes, I'm aware of it, and he didn't elaborate on it. Apparently, he is caught by all kinds of traps which the Americans and the Europeans are still stuck in, and he cannot come with something too innovative. He might do it with the years, but it requires to abolish the PA.
Okay. Question in the back.
On the 25th of June, there's a major meeting in Bahrain, sponsored by Americans and Jared Kushner. To what extent do you see that coming out? Will it be different or more successful than the kinds of proposals in the past to address the issues you have spoken to?
Thank you so much, brother. First of all, the Palestinians already rejected it. Because, well, not the Palestinians, the PA. And I define here between the Palestinians and the PA. The PA is an illegitimate entity which was created by Israel to serve the Israeli interests. This is why it's illegitimate. They already rejected it because, in their view, you cannot tie the wagon before the horses. Means the economic issue before the political issues. They want first Jerusalem, they want to bring back all the refugees into Israel proper, they want to solve the problem of the borders, they want everything before you touch the issues of economy. However, Americans and other Westerners think from the point of view that if you give them money, good income, good house, good car, and a swimming pool in the backyard, they will be peaceful. People here do not understand that in the Middle East, only if people are peaceful, they will have money. It doesn't go, it's one way road. It's not if you give them money, they will be peaceful. No, they will steal the money. Look what happened with the money of the PA. Most of the money goes to the numbered bank accounts in Switzerland, which belong to these to the officials. You know, I'll give you a good example. What happens in the PA with the money, which I believe come from this country as well. I have a friend in Rhinelander where I live. He is a dealer of Rolex watches. You know, you don't buy it from the display. It doesn't have any display. He has a catalog. You sit with the catalog. This one is $80,000. This one is $250,000. This is $350,000. Okay, and you go and you order it. Now, the most expensive are those with stones around the plate. And you know, it's not limestones. Okay? So, he once told me, the friend, that the most expensive watches of Rolex were bought by the officials of the Palestinian Authority, who are employees. Oops, an employee who live on a salary? How can he afford such a thing? Okay, all kinds of corruption. Then after like a year, he comes to me and says, you have no idea what happens now. They bring back the watches, they pay more money to add stones on the wrist. Why? In Rolex, you are allowed as a customer only to change the battery. This is what you are allowed to do. Anything else, if you touch, you lose the warranty. You have to give it back, and you have lifetime warranty on the on Rolex. Okay? Well, I'm not trying to promote it, but this is the situation. Okay? I don't have any shares. Now, they bring back the watches to add stones, because if they add it by themselves, they will lose the warranty, even on the wrist. So they send the watch back to Switzerland, to the factory. They send the money, and they get it back with more stones around the wrist. Okay, this is the policy. This is why the PA is viewed as illegitimate, while the people have to work and to sweat in order to gain some money. The officials buy the most expensive watches, custom made.
So there are many questions. This gentleman,
and the lady.
Go ahead.
Get back to the idea about the late Arab Emirates. I remember you shared in a lecture a few years ago, and after that I discussed the idea with Solomon Ben Simra. And he expressed the concern that eight new Arab states will have probably eight new seats in the United Nations, which only will increase the anti-Semitism. Do you share that concern? And the second question is, what is your opinion about the United Nations? Because Israel, that membership, it's only resolution after resolution, trashing Israel. So
the two questions are on that.
The first is about, look,
eight states.
Look, Salom Ben Zimra of blessed memory was right. Definitely, eight more Arab countries is a problem. But it is a price which, in my view, is worth to pay in order to achieve the advantages of this plan on the ground. Okay? By the way, if they make a federation, they have only one seat, like the United Arab Emirates have one seat. So it's not at all sure that they will have eight. If they made the federation, the world will give them only one seat. This is one thing. Second thing, about the
United Nations.
Right. Look, I have a lot to say about the I once was invited to Denver, Colorado, to give a lesson about international organizations, and I dedicated it to the destructive role which the United Nations play all over the Middle East. But only to answer your question. Article 80 of the Charter of the United Nations mentions clearly that the United Nations adopt all the decisions of the League of Nations, which was the former organization, including the Sanremo decision to give the land of Israel to the Jews. Means, in the Charter of the United Nations, already embedded a decision to give the land of Israel, means from the river to the sea, to the Jewish people only. However, you can see that many decisions of the United Nations contradict this decision. So, an organization which negates itself is not an organization. It's a balagan. It's a chaos. It's a circus. Why? It's a joke. And unfortunately, all of a sudden they forgot about the Jewish heritage of Jerusalem. Because UNESCO decides that Jerusalem is holy only for Muslims and Christians. Okay. Yeah, this is the decision. Okay. And Hebron never was anything with Jews. You know, the Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob were all Muslims, of course, according to the Islamic mindset. What they want, when an organization is sponsored by Qatar, the state which sponsors all the jihadi organizations which belong to the Sunnah part of Islam, what do you expect? That such an organization would say anything good about Israel? So this is what I think about the international arena.
Question here. According to the late Bernard Lewis and many other observers, in Arab culture, any sign that an enemy is willing and desirous of compromising is a sign of weakness.
Of course.
So doesn't that suggest that present any government of Israel should take a much stronger stand with Judea and Samaria?
Of course.
Beginning with the extension, I don't use the word annexation because I don't understand how you can annex what belongs to you. Israel should immediately,
declare,
extend sovereignty to at least Area C, where very few Palestinians live.
Well, this is now on the table, or on the desk, because this was on the platform of the right parties in the recent elections. So now Netanyahu has to pay the check which he signed before the elections, and we hope that he will do it at least for Area C, definitely. By the way, in the Middle East, you start a negotiation by saying everything belongs to me and I don't want peace with you.
Thank you.
Now the price goes down.
Here's the question.
Yes. Is the chaos of clan and culture why Turkey, which had every chance of seeming to be a state and has tried to be a secular state since the 1920s, why it seems to have fallen back 80 years in the last 10 years? And how does that affect Israel, which had in a sense counted on Turkey at one point?
Good question. For really answering what happened with Turkey, what went wrong with Turkey, I will have to come here again. But in order to answer you, let me tell you something. Turkey started its modern life as a secular country by Mustafa Kemal Ataturk, who saw Islam as some kind of backwardness. His direction of prayer was London and Paris. This is where he derived his... after all, Britain and France defeated the Ottoman army where he was a general. So he understood that what stuck us in history means in fatigue situation was the Islam. And these are different because they are Christians. So the Christianity actually opened their mind. But his direction of prayer was to the West. And he imposed secularism on the society of Turkey. Okay? In Iran, to compare, the Shah imposed secularism as well. So they nominated Khomeini. In Turkey, they had Mustafa Kemal, who was secular, so they came back to Islam. However, 40 years, the Ayatollahs rule Iran. Today, most of the Iranians do not remember when they saw a mosque from within. The Iranian society today is 95% secular to their teeth. The society. The regime is pseudo-religious. But, okay, and here's the answer. Whenever you impose secularism, people go back to religion. Whenever you impose religion, people refrain from going to the mosque. People always do the opposite of what the regime imposes on them because they hate the regime and they hate the agenda of the regime. And this is the rule. This is a social rule. Here, there, means in Iran and Turkey, and what happens here, I don't know. Because, at least in the United States, when you see a president who is ultra-leftist, like Obama, the result is Trump. But Obama, don't forget, was the result of Bush. And Bush was the result of Clinton. Okay? A pendulum. When you push people to one side, they push to go to the other side. And when they are pushed to the other side, they want to go to this side, like a pendulum. And this is what happens in your neighbors in the south.
We got 2020. Question here, and then a question here, and then we're probably out of time.
I wonder if there are any interests aligning between Saudi Arabia and Israel beyond the fear of Iran that could outlive the priesthood of MBS. Question, and if there were a regime change in Iran that was more pro-Western, how that would change the map of everything. And I know from it, it's probably hard as Israeli to think that far ahead, but we usually don't think of things that haven't existed, don't exist on the ground.
Look, until 4 or 5 years ago, since the Iranian problem started to be acute or to be viewed as acute, the relations between Israel and Saudi Arabia were almost nothing. Well, they didn't have much against us. Once, in the Red Sea, an Israeli ship which belonged to the Navy had a problem with the engine, and it stopped, and it was pushed by the currents to the Saudi shore. The ship, the Saudis didn't do anything. Israel worked for like 2 or 3 days in order to pull this ship out, including going on the Saudi soil, and the Saudis didn't offer us water, but they stood inside just to make sure that the Israelis are taking the ship and doing nothing. So, you know, they're not that hostile. Not only this, there is a guy in Israel named Professor Moshe Mani. He is a urologist, very famous in Israel. He was the manager general of the Ministry of Health. He was the head of the Sheba Health Hospital. He was the rector of Tel Aviv University for a while, and he was the head of the medical school in Tel Aviv University. Okay, very well-known professor. I think he's still alive, very, very old today. He is originally from Baghdad, from Iraq, and he speaks Arabic. And for many years, he used to disappear twice a year for a week. Nobody knew where he goes. Only one man knew, the prime minister. He left every time a note on the prime minister's desk, "I'm leaving, you know where to." The man would take a flight to Greece or to Cyprus. A private jet used to wait for him there, which belonged to a guy named Adnan Khashoggi, the uncle of the guy who was sold. And he took him, this private jet, to a private airport near Riyadh, where you don't have to go through the immigration. And he was taken to the palace to take care of the most sensitive problems of the ruling family, both men and women. He did it for years, And nobody knew that he is the one who takes care of them. And until he stopped and he asked permission to try. So once it was written in Israeli paper. At some point, the Saudi king asked him, how much do I have to pay you? So he said, you don't have enough. The Saudis don't have enough. So don't start with payment. Don't talk about this because you don't have enough. Now, why didn't he take money? Because a man who lives on salary in Israel cannot all of a sudden buy a house without explanation. Where did he get the money? Of course, if he got the money, he got it in cash. He wouldn't get a check from the Saudi government, okay? A man who is a rector in university or a manager of a hospital, he lives on a salary, and not such a big one, in spite of the wide wings which he has. Okay, so how can he explain all of a sudden a million of cash? So he preferred not to take. Anyway, he cannot do anything with this. Otherwise, he will go where Olmert went, and Netanyahu might join the place. Okay?
For a Boston cigar.
Okay. So this is why the man...
Yeah, isn't that silly?
The man understood that it's not for money. Now, the question is, why did the Saudis take an Israeli urologist? This is actually the tradition in the Arab world, in the Islamic world. Many caliphs, many sultans, many rulers kept a Jewish doctor. Maimonides, Rabbi Yehuda Levi, many were doctors. Why? First of all, they were good doctors, I believe. Secondly, doctors in those times were also the pharmacists, means those who produced the medications. The easiest thing was to poison the ruler in order to take his place. But the Jew was not suspected because Jews never had any aspiration to become the rulers. So the Jews do not have any motivation to poison the ruler. They didn't trust each other because, you know, many brothers killed their brothers, you know, in feuds and struggles over the government. But the Jew is not suspected. So this is why they took Jewish doctors. Both because they were good doctors and because they were not suspected to poison the ruler. Okay?
Dr. Kedar, this is one example where I don't remember the question, but I love the answer.
You know, you're right. I also... by the way, the rule number one in media interview is... No matter what the question was, yeah. You say what you want to say. Yes,
just in the interest of time, another 5 minutes, but go, I want to make sure everyone has a chance to talk.
I have a dilemma. I have so many questions, so I have to choose one.
Start with the last.
Okay. I'll deal with one that you haven't been talking about. Tel Aviv University and Hebrew University, they have been celebrating Nakba Day. How do you explain that position of these universities celebrating what everything that can be done against defending Israel's rights?
Well, the universities as organization did not celebrate.
No. Tel Aviv University and
Hebrew
and University. Hebrew U are celebrating Nakba Day, and of course, how can that happen?
Well, just to correct a little. Misunderstanding. It's not the university as a body celebrated this Nakba. The university allows all kind of organizations to walk on campus, from Im Tirzu to the right, all the way to Arab organizations which belong to the Islamic movement, which is a Muslim brotherhood, anti-Jewish, anti-Israeli, sheer anti-Israeli. They walk on campus as well. Why? Freedom of speech. Okay? Universities, you know, are sanctuaries of freedoms in Israel as well. So sometimes you like what Im Tirzu is doing, sometimes you don't like what ICRA or other organizations which commemorate the Nakba are doing. Okay, so this is an open arena, whether we like it or not. Unfortunately, this open arena actually infiltrates into the classrooms where professors allow themselves to disseminate propaganda in class using their authority and their actually the fact that they are in charge of the future of the students. So they actually coerce the students to think as they think in a political way. One of my former positions, I was the temporary president of an organization named the Israel Academia Monitor. And this organization actually monitors what happens in the academia, political bias, both from the left and the right. Because as much as I agree or want that the classroom will not be a propaganda place for the communists and the ultra-leftists, I do not want the class to be captured by ultra-right. Because this is wrong and this is wrong. And if you as a professor give a position or political position, you should play it, but you should also play the other side. If you want, let's say, to say something for, you know, how communists would do it, you can play the communists, it's okay. In condition that after you finish the communist show, now you step to the other side. So, okay, now I'll tell you what the right thinks. And now we'll become the one of the most vociferous speakers of the right. If you as a professor know how to play the role, it's okay. You let the students decide what they take. And you have to be even-handed, you have to be honest with both sides of the political. If this is the professor, it is more than okay, because this way you teach the students to think, but only if you give the two sides fully with all your soul. How you do it? You have to be a good actor.
Okay.
To play a role which you don't believe in.
So there was a question, Ruth, and then Lloyd, and then we'll have to conclude.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Yeah, you were talking about Turkey and Iran and saying if you push people one way, they'll go the other way. But then you were lots and lots of small tribes all over the place, and they've been pushed by their leaders, and they haven't.
They're not pushed by their leaders.
What are they doing?
The leaders reflect the culture. The leaders are not rulers. The leaders are real, legitimate, accepted, wanted leaders. And this is the difference. They're not rulers.
Right.
They don't push the people anywhere. And anything which they decide, it's always by round table of the heads of the families. You know, the state of Oman today, near Saudi Arabia. This is how the caboose, the sultan, runs the country. He is there for more than 40 years as not a ruler, as a leader. Every morning starts with a breakfast of the six leaders of the six group of tribes. And that breakfast actually goes into lunch. Why? They discuss everything.
That sounds terribly fair and democratic.
Well, let's move to Oman. Anyway, one last question, and then we'll have our thank you remarks for Dr.
Teddy Bellman, a Toronto boy, lawyer, made Aliyah a number of years ago. He's working with
Mudar
Zahran. They have what they call the Jordan option. In a nutshell, it's the Hashemites will be disposed or goodbye, and this new group with parliamentary democracy will take over and make a country in Jordan for the Palestinians. Donald Trump, who you may have heard of, has been talking with his son-in-law of some option that's going to be the deal of the century. Are they compatible? Do you know what I'm talking about? What are the possibilities?
Well, what Ted Bellman tries to promote is a man named Mudar Zahran who poses himself as the most legitimate leader of Jordan, although he lives in London on benefits. I know him personally. I met him several times. in Israel and in London, and I correspond with them almost on a daily basis. And I was actually part of the beginning of the of this conference in Jerusalem, which was there last September, 2 years ago.
October.
This is now. Some people say that Mudar Zahran is a joke. Some people say that he is the real thing. Well, to know if he's a real joke, if he's a joke or the real thing, I have to go to Jordan and disseminate forms, you know, questionnaires, and to see what people answer. But it's not easy because the kingdom doesn't allow such a thing in Jordan. So I have to live on what he says and what others say, and try to understand from what people tell me what the truth is, and it's not easy at all. This is about this. I really don't know what. Look, Jordan has a majority of Palestinians, a minority of Bedouins, but the minority of Bedouins actually all over the majority of Palestinians. The Bedouins are the government, the Palestinians are in business, and they carry on their back the whole country, means the economic back. The Hashemite family tries to negotiate with everybody to accept the family. The family is not local, and people look at them as who are you, who brought you? The British actually brought them in the 20s. In order to bridge over the gap between the family, the ruling family, who bases on the Bedouins and the Palestinian majority, the king married a Palestinian lady, Rani. Okay? As if, you know, like, as it was in Europe for hundreds of years, the Habsburgs and the others, how they married each other. So the Palestinians, means they saw that one of their sisters married the king, who is not from them. So the whole world sees it as a positive way, like a bridge between the groups. The Palestinians...